Have you ever wondered how multiplayer games look behind the curtains? What is at their core? Why they sometimes behave in funny ways? In today's topic, we will look at the fundamental principles of networking physics and demystify their behavior. Physics is the fundamental part of every simulation. It represents the state of the world. Every simulation has an input and gives out an output. In games, inputs are, for example, key presses, while outputs are the player's position. The goal of networking physics is that every client has the same worldview on their screen. There are two important aspects to consider here. The precision of the simulation, so all objects should have the same positions on all clients, and immediate control, so regardless of connection, all controls should be immediate. The problems we run into are network bandwidth limitations and network response times. It is important to note that there is no ideal solution for this problem, but we will present two possible solutions. In this chapter, we will take a look at three techniques of networking physics that are currently in use in the games industry. The fundamental choice we have to make is which part of the simulation we will network. Remember, a simulation has an input and an output, so these are our two choices. What choice we make will propagate throughout the entire game. Deterministic lockstep is a technique in which we send the inputs of a simulation, since a simulation that has the same inputs will give the same outputs, resulting in a theoretically infinitely detailed world that is fully synchronized to all clients. There are a couple of technical problems with this method. Firstly, the simulation needs to be deterministic, meaning, given the same inputs, it always gives the same outputs. This is solved with a checksum. Secondly, it is very hard to guarantee that the floating point numbers will be rounded up in the same way in every environment, thereby ruining determinism. The simulation needs to run in discrete fixed time steps, or lockstep, so that all clients can be synchronized more easily. To execute one simulation step, we must receive all inputs, meaning we will have to wait for the client with the biggest network response time. As the number of clients increases, so does the chance for a networking error. Persistent worlds need special attention. If a new client wants to join a deterministic lockstep simulation, he must receive and execute all of the inputs that happened. A persistent simulation could run for a few hours or years, depending on its design, resulting in huge packets. These are all technically solvable issues, but require that the environment is designed around them. So, we require a physics system that is completely deterministic across multiple platforms and works in lockstep. To solve the problem of networking response times, we use a system of rewinding and playback. Preferably, the physics system runs in a separate thread from the game thread, so that we don't need to lock the FPS. All of the mentioned methods are implemented in the new Unreal Engine Chaos physics system. The only problem that we don't know the solution to is the persistence problem, which will probably be solved with a state sync method. More on this later. In this technique, both the client and the server execute the physics simulation. The client runs it so that he can have immediate control and the possibility of rewind and playback, while the server runs it so it can approve or discard inputs and distribute them to the clients. An advantage of networking only inputs is that you have no practical limitations on the world size and precision. The context for this issue will be given in the overview of other methods. This technique is used mostly for single platform games, usually RTS titles with lots of units like Age of Empires. But Epic Games seems to be shifting to it as well, or at least supporting it. This is a consequence of their desire to support chaos destruction over a network, which brings an exceptional amount of detail to a simulation, making it very difficult to network with other methods. Let's now take a look at the limitations of this system. We assume that the movement is supported through 6 degrees of freedom, and that we have 20 abilities. This results in 32 possible inputs or 32 bits, depending on whether they are active or not in a single moment. We assume it's being sent at 30 Hz. This results in 960 bits per second per client. On the server side, with a 10 gigabit per second link, we can receive some 10.5 million inputs. The theoretical number of players we can support is the root of this number. Remember, we must receive all inputs to simulate one step. This works out to about 3,227 players. The client's bandwidth is therefore 3.1 megabits per second. To give you some context, with the 100 gigabit per second link, this works out to 10,206 players at a client bandwidth of 9.8 megabits per second. At 60 Hz, which is an industry standard for physics simulations, and a 10 gigabit per second link, we get 1920 bits per second for inputs, which leads to 2282 players. It should be noted that we would probably encounter both server and client-side processor limitations first, rather than bandwidth, but these depend on the implementation of the rewind system and the simulation's fidelity. Let's now conclude with some advantages and disadvantages of this technique, assuming all technical problems are solved. The advantages are that all clients are almost immediately aware of the entire simulation. The simulation can be infinitely detailed. Client packet size is very small. We are not limited by floating point size constraints, allowing for huge worlds. The disadvantages are it is very hard to scale client numbers, since we are limited by server bandwidth. To ensure sync, we need all inputs, no matter where they happened. It must run on the client, so we are limited by the lower end of hardware requirements. And lastly, it is very technically demanding to implement. Theoretically, if we could spatially optimize this technique, it could support even more players. Snapshot interpolation is a concept in which we send the outputs of a simulation, meaning the positions of all objects. In this technique, only the server executes the physics simulation, while the client only lerps or animates objects from their old position to the new one. In most cases, it does not require a lockstep approach, meaning it is much easier to execute and easily supports persistent worlds. In terms of usage, all of the games we looked at in the last chapter uses technique, and so do nearly all FPS games. Positional data consists of a vector for position, so 96 bits, and a quaternion for rotation, which is 128 bits. In total, that's 224 bits, and this is obviously too much for the server to handle, and it must be optimized. To find out how we can compress this data, you can visit the Gaffron Games article for more detail. In short, we round up the numbers as much as we can, losing some precision. Furthermore, we use delta compression, as in we only send the changes relative to their previous position. This is not always used, as it can be costly, since we need to send acknowledge packets. After these optimizations, we arrive at an average 83-bit packet for a single positional update. This ultimately limits this technique to a floating point number with a 32-bit size, meaning the simulation can only process coordinates of a 20-kilometer-squared sized world. Most games upgrade snapshot interpolation with state sync. This combines deterministic lockstep for immediate input on some objects, while selectively updating positional data for all other objects. To selectively update positional data, we use a priority accumulator, which determines the priority of an object's positional update, based on the time that passed since its last update and its proximity to the client. This is a somewhat CPU-intense process, since it is done on a per-client basis and can be a limiting factor when scaling the number of clients, depending on the fidelity of the simulation. Its biggest advantage is the ability to limit the client bandwidth to an acceptable amount, usually around 350 kilobytes per second. Thanks to this technique, we can have a high fidelity world that is at least partially synchronized across all clients. This is also the biggest drawback with this technique, since the clients never know the true state of the simulation. Like we saw in the previous chapter, an acceptable rate of refresh is around 20 to 30 Hz, and the bare minimum is 10 Hz. For example, Apex Legends uses it at 20 Hz with 100 players and only 75 milliseconds of delay. This technique is in fact used in Unreal Engine 4, which uses lockstep for its character movement and state sync for all their objects. It uses a maximum distance, called netcode distance squared, to determine relevancy, so if something should be replicated, and then prioritizes the object. It even has a tendency to update objects in front of the player more frequently, but it is much weaker than the one in Battlefield 4. If inappropriately configured, it can ruin immersion and realism. For example, in the following video, the game Hell Let Loose configured buildable objects to load in at a shorter distance than other players, meaning players can be seen but not shot through a buildable sandbag. Furthermore, if it's too aggressively optimized and under a high load, it can lead to severe desynchronization events, such as those seen in Scavengers. During their high player count tests, where they achieved 4,138 players but experienced total positional loss, it should be noted that this is the worst case scenario for this technique, where every player can be seen by all other players. We will explore the theoretical player limit of this technique in another topic. Let's now conclude with some advantages and disadvantages of this technique. The advantages are, it has a flexible bandwidth, clients don't need to run the physics simulation, and it can be spatially optimized. The disadvantages are, it has a technically limited number of physical objects. Clients never really know the state of the simulation. Optimizations can be costly for server performance. Optimizations do not work in a high-density environment. The size of the world is limited because of floating point number size issues. When choosing the technique for our project, we need to understand our needs and limitations. The first question you need to ask yourself is what techniques are supported in your environment. With Unreal Engine 4, only state sync is really well supported. In fact, the entire networking stack is focused on it. So it's an obvious choice, and this project will use it as well. If you're making a large-scale RTS, you would nearly always choose deterministic lockstep, since the fidelity of the world is much less of a concern for this technique. But you will have a hard time finding an engine that has it well supported. Now that we have built up a solid understanding of networking and its limitations, we can finally start working on our multi-server architecture, which will open up many more networking possibilities. Be sure to come back next week. Thank you for watching.